What's going on, you guys? Welcome to Liberate Your Money, episode 51. It is January 22nd. Got about a week left of the month, and the markets are dying. We've got the stock market going down. We've got crypto going down. The correlation between the two is on point. What stocks do, crypto does. Oh, it's been extreme fear since November now. So we've almost got basically got two straight months of just downward spiral and pain in the markets. And lots of fear. And historically, this is a good time to buy. But we've been in extreme fear for so long right now. Things are going down for so long. It's when's it gonna end, right? And I think if you didn't take profits, we've been talking about taking profits for a while. I mean, a couple months now, especially on our altcoins. And, you know, I'm super glad I did that. I've actually got some stink bids that got hit the other day, which actually kind of made me uncomfortable once they actually got hit, because you think the market's going to keep going down. But I'm happy with where they're at. I bought some near. I'm looking to buy a couple other things, but I'm also kind of unsure where we're headed next. I kind of want to see Monday's open for stocks and see what happens there. It looks like there could be some more downside, and if that happens, I think we could see more downside in crypto as well. And none of these bounces that we're seeing right now are very convincing. But look, we're sitting at a major support level. This is the monthly chart, and we're sitting at the bottom of the June or the July open, which is also in confluence with this trend line here. I noticed it on the daily. I had a tweet about it on the 14th. I said I'd like to see the 30s hold and begin to form an ascending triangle from this trend line. On the daily, you can see we kind of fought at resistance going up. It wasn't that big of a resistance level, but it was a big support level because it bounced here and then it also bounced here. So that's kind of why I thought it was a decent trend line. So what happened was yesterday it actually came down and tagged that trend line exactly. And now we're basically just hovering on this trend line. Like I said, there is confluence at this level on the monthly, especially, but I just, you know, I think it's, if you're buying spot, I think it's, I've started buying some spot things. You know, we're down over 50% from the high, or we were when it was below 34.5, because our high was 69K, right? So confluence at this level, I do think that there's a good chance that we calm down and test this yearly open, guys, which is basically the low at that 28.9. We can just call it 29K, somewhere around there. I think it's highly likely that we test it or get close. As you can see down here, look, we didn't completely test the bottom back in 2020. We got close though, right? We got pretty dang close, and I think that we're probably going to do something similar here where we get down at least very close to that 28.9K, maybe even go past it. In my last video, I talked about the scenario where, look, maybe we get past this 30K, 28.9K, which is the yearly open in 2020, have like that scary double top neckline breakthrough, and maybe retest this region or even front run it a little bit. I think we'll probably front run it. I don't actually think we'll get down to 20K and retest that old all-time high. I think there's just too much demand for Bitcoin, but look, I could be totally wrong. If Bitcoin goes back to 20K or 19K, I mean, you can basically expect Ethereum to be at least 1800 and below. And look, that would be in confluence with what we talked about in our last video with this Arthur Hayes article, where he said he was predicting the Fed was going to have to raise rates, and that was going to cause, he thought, at least three cascading events, which would bring the price of Bitcoin down to that 20,000 range and Ethereum below that 2,000 range. So he's predicting lower prices. A lot of OG traders are predicting lower prices, predicting that yearly open to get hit or retested. I think the good thing, guys, is that like this is happening really quickly. You know, it's really painful because things are going down fast. Like, look at these 3 months. In 3 months, we washed 50% of the value. But I think, look, they say the first trillion in market cap is the hardest for any asset. And I think that's showing us to be true, right? I mean, this level right here, we'll call it 54K, is about the trillion market cap number for Bitcoin. And we just struggled with it. I mean, we got there quickly and got above it, closed above it, and then just crashed through it. And we did the exact same thing over here. So clearly the first trillion is just like, it's a really tough level to break. But look, we're still holding these range lows. I think if we test that open, we're still within this range. And if we hold the range, I think that looks really good, because look, in my mind, the consolidation for the bear market started here in April of 2021, which would mean that we've already got 10 months in this bear market of consolidation. I mean, I don't necessarily want to call it a bear market, but we're ranging, right? So we've got that many months under our belt of consolidation, if this is consolidation. Now, this could be distribution. If that's the case, then look, this is going to be sideways. We'll probably get underneath this or hover around this 28K for a really long time, have a liquidation event, and then go up from there, you know, sometime close to the halving. But, you know, I really don't know. I'm starting to think that we've already started this consolidation, and the longer we stay above that 28.9K, I think it starts to look, you know, bullish for another leg up. Because look, long consolidations like this precede large moves like this. Consolidations like this precede moves like this, right? Consolidation moves like this. Consolidation moves like this. So we just need some consolidation. And look, that can take longer than you want to believe, right? I mean, the good thing is that we have the supply shock with the halvings with Bitcoin. So around that 2024, when we have the next halving, you're going to be wanting to look for longs. But in the more short term, I think this is looking more and more like consolidation, especially if we can hold this trend line, if we can hold these range lows. I think it starts to look really good from a long-term perspective, especially, you know, if we can find a bottom here, maybe get back up and retest that trillion market cap. You know, we've got a lot of resistance to get through to do that, and I'm sure a lot of people are underwater on their bags. See, that's what happens with this. You get a lot of people that buy the top, and this move right here definitely didn't help the situation, right? A lot of people, you know, either sold and relonged or bought more, and now they're like underwater big time and don't want to lose anymore. So like, once you get down to these levels, it could push us lower. That's why I think we could see a deviation below, you know, just like a panic capitulation. And maybe that doesn't happen until somewhere later in the year. You know, maybe we get a decent bounce and then we, you know, just keep going ranging basically. So we'll just have to see. I do like this take here. You know, with stocks and crypto and everything going down, it seems to be just the narrative, right? It's been the narrative for a while. The Fed was talking about raising interest rates. They haven't done that yet. It's been all talk. And I think the markets are pricing that in before it actually happens. And BitBit kind of explains his point here, like everything is priced in before it happens. So here I am calling this now. The day they hike rates, and beginning QE, I think is what he, or no, he's QT, that must be the tapering, is the day you want to long everything. It's simple, because after the bad news is already out, there will be no more sellers left. And I think he's got a point, especially if we see inflation along with this pullback. You know, people don't want to hold cash for that long. If we got 7% inflation, what good is your, you know, net wealth sitting in cash? You know, eventually they're going to be looking for that yield again, and markets will bounce and will continue the uptrend. I mean, I don't think stocks are done and we're going to see like a 50% pullback. I could be wrong, but like, I don't think they're going to allow that to happen just yet. I think they've got a lot of weapons in their tool shed to use still. Like, I mean, they haven't even raised interest rates yet. So like, I think it is kind of one of those, the market's pricing it in right now. And if we wait and see what happens around when they actually do something, I think that'll probably be mark the bottom and we'll probably see an upturn. You know, people will be expecting the downturn, shorting it. Oh, they're tapering. And then like, we'll see this massive bounce and it'll be incredible. So that's another good take I like to think about. Let's take a look at some look into Bitcoin charts. We talked about this website and how they have some pretty juicy charts that can tell us good times to sell and buy. Let's look at the MVRV score. We're not quite in that green range, the maximum risk reward green buy zone. But we're pretty close, right? I mean, the red was way up here. Now we're like within one score of being in the green. So that would probably be in confluence with like, look, this is the 200 weekly up here. Maybe we do come down, test that, and bounce and get that last little bit down into this green. If we look at where it is, the Puel, this has to do with miners. Looks at the supply of Bitcoin's economy, buying Bitcoin miners and their revenue. So yeah, it's getting close to that buy zone again, right? We're pretty far from the sell zone. So like, obviously a lot of the downside, I think, for this move is already happened. Now look, we can go lower, but like, I think we're getting close to that buy. 200 week moving average heat map. It's down at 19K. That's like massive support. If it ever gets down there, you buy without even thinking. I mean, you don't even have to think about it. You just buy. I mean, that's just, it's the strongest support zone it's ever had in the history of the asset class. You just have to buy it. Stock to flow, I don't like using this chart because obviously it's a failing metric, but I like the colors on the chart. If you look, it's the days until next halving. And whenever we were in this green, look, we were around the top of the cycle, right? This has a lot to do with Bitcoin's. I think, you know, the timing of Bitcoin is beautiful because like human cycles tend to be cyclical, just like the Bitcoin halving in like multiples of years. And I think we're seeing in the chart confluence between that and the Bitcoin halving. And I don't know, it's just a beautiful thing to see how reflexive the markets are and how much they rhyme, you know? And it just has a lot to do with human behavior in markets and just like the supply and the Bitcoin halving and all of that just mixed together. So I thought that was interesting, right? Whenever we're in the green, that's always marked around the top of the cycle. So we are definitely in the green. So I think if you're buying stuff, you really gotta just be cautious. Like if, you know, short-term play is what you gotta think, because markets could go really lower and stay there for a while, because like in bear markets, everybody's looking to get out. So when things start to pump, they get sold off relatively quickly, right? I mean, right now, we can't even get a pump. It's just being sold off instantly because there's so much fear in the markets. Let's look at the golden ratio multiplier. This is good. Good place to show us when to buy. Look, whenever it's been below this orange, it's been a good time to buy. But look, it can hang below the orange a lot longer than you want to think, right? It can hang below the orange a lot longer than you think. But whenever it's been below there, historically has been a good time to buy. So if you're buying spot, this is a good place to maybe average a little bit. Unrealized profits and losses. So yeah, see, there's still a lot of people that could be taking profits, right? People are still in denial that this market is going down on the downside. We never even reached euphoria this cycle, which, well, actually, yeah, we did. The relative unrealized profit loss never reached euphoria. But yeah, we have some room to go. Some people that are still in profit haven't taken profits or are still up. And look, like, the market has a really funny way of squeezing a lot of people out of their positions. You know, I hold long-term Bitcoin. I know it's going to be painful in the next few months, but like, it's an asset I'm willing to hold on to, and you know, pretty bullish on Bitcoin. It's a scarce asset in a world where they're printing away our money. So I think on the on-chain metrics, we're getting some of them already flashing those buy signals. Other ones are just, you know, approaching their buy signal. So look, we're looking for longs. We're looking for long-term plays. We're looking for you know, averaging in just a little bit at a time. I did want to talk about Raul Paul. I meant to bring up that tweet. Let me see if I can find his Twitter really fast and bring up that chart. He was comparing Amazon to the Bitcoin chart, and I like the analogy for a couple reasons. It's actually the time period that he's comparing Amazon to. If you look at the chart, it's from 2009 into 2010. And this was 13 years into Amazon. Amazon started in 97, and 13 years into Amazon would be right about the same time we're 13 years into Bitcoin, 13 or 14, somewhere around there. So it's, I like the analogy because the time period for a tech company, they're both 13 years old, and their charts look insanely similar. Like, I mean, he's got a point here. Like, obviously, they don't look exactly, but, like, the overall pattern looks the same. I mean, we have this choppy distribution at the top, choppy distribution at the top. We come down and bottom. We have this little deviation down, and then we keep going back up. Same thing, right? Go back up. And what's interesting is that, look, we had the same, like, double top pattern where they make the new all-time high, just like Bitcoin did. Made that new all-time high. Came, and it actually went past the lows, guys. So, like, it kind of coincides with what I was talking about here, right? We can get below, deviate below, and then make our way back up. I think that's what we're going to see. That would be, like, max pain, right? Markets have a tendency to give max pain. And I think that's like a, you know, if we do end up seeing the same type of network effects like Amazon, maybe we get that flush past that, which would coincide with what we were talking about. It would test that yearly open at 28.9K, get a little bit below it, rinse some of those early longs, and then get that V bottom and start working our way back up. So I'm hoping we see something like that. I do want to pull up the chart for Amazon just to show you guys what happened after that consolidation on Amazon back in 2009-2010. Let's go back in time here. Let's put it on the daily chart so we can see. And I'm going to do the line chart. That way you can see it better. Alright, zoom me back out. Okay. So here it is. So this would be like the March 2020 crash in Bitcoin. Remember, we were consolidating in 2019. We were looking like we were going to bounce here and continue the trend up. And then we had the COVID. And that brought us down, way down. We had this crazy liquidation event. And then we made this this rally, and then we had the Bitcoin halving right here in May, and then we rallied up to 60K, and this is that 60K run where we chop at the top, and then we fell down to back down to 30K. This would be that 30K level, and then we bounced again, 50K back down to 40K, and then we bounced up to 69K, and then we had this fast sell-off like we're seeing right now. And right now, we're like right here in this sell-off. So like we could chop more, go down more, chop more, go down more, get that flush below that 30K. And then look what happens after that. It rallies hard for the next year. You know, from September 2010 to basically September 2011. So yeah, a year, it rallied after that. And look, I don't know if we're going to get that year rally. I don't know if it's going to do this, but like the chart is undeniable, especially around the same time period. And we're talking about a tech company, and Bitcoin is a tech. So this could be more not about like what Bitcoin does, you know, because obviously Bitcoin is a monetary asset and Amazon is a tech company. But like, if you think about how tech reaches people and how people start to use that technology, it's very similar. And I would argue that Bitcoin's very similar because it's something that you can do on your phone. You know, anybody can get a wallet and just start using it. And that's kind of the same concept as Amazon. You create an account and you start using it. Like, you're buying a monetary asset with Bitcoin. With Amazon, you're buying just like goods, you know? So very similar tech companies, their charts look very similar around that same 13-year time period of their existence. And look, hopefully we do see that. Hopefully we get that flush past 28.9K or get around to it, and then we see that rally. But I think you just got to be cautious with your buys right now. Think short term. I think, you know, keep stop losses if you want to protect your capital, or if this isn't an asset that you want to hold until the next halving. Like, honestly, anything you buy now or anything you're holding now, you have to say to yourself, am I comfortable holding this, you know, through excruciating price changes until the next halving? And the scary thing about that is, like, you don't know what the next narrative is going to be in the next cycle. So, like, the coins that you're holding might not even be very popular in the next cycle. And even though they're popular now and they have all these network effects going for them, like, bear markets can really fuck up a project. I mean, people, you know, they bail on the project, they give up on it. There's just so much time and energy that goes into it that, you know, they either move on to different things or start different projects, or something new comes along and, you know, it's the next big thing, right? It's why the top 10 of crypto is like different every bull cycle, is because, you know, there's really only been a few of them that stuck around up there, which is Bitcoin and Ethereum, and that's pretty much it. So really, that's all I got, guys. I hope you guys are safe. You know, having cash on hand, I think, is how you can capitalize on these massive red dips. And look, like, whenever Bitcoin's been 40% plus from its all-time highs, usually been a good time to average in some. So not financial advice, but I am on the buying outlook, right? I love seeing, you know, low prices on assets that I like, because I want to buy them. But all right, guys, that's all I got. I'll catch you guys in the next video. Stay safe. All right, peace out.